If you'll please find your seat and open your hymnal, stand and open your hymnal to page number 29. We'll start with At the Cross.
From the Hiddleville family. It says, "Dear supporters and friends, I received some news recently concerning the work we plan to take over this year upon our return. The man who is over it now and his family plan to leave this week. Our original plan was to be back in the country before they leave. Now the possibility exists that the people we'll have to meet for a month and a half or so without a preacher. Though I cannot be with them physically right now, I'm planning to make some video messages so they can still hear preaching. My desire is to return right now, but believe it necessary to attend to my current health situation a little longer. I am encouraged by the fact that the people had to meet a couple of weeks without the preacher due to COVID reasons. During his absence, they continued to meet on their own. I ask that you would keep them in your prayers to reach the lost in Romania, the Hiltonville family. Now is our prayer time. We need to pray for rain or snow or moisture, whatever may come. So let's pray. please help all the teens who are going to be doing all the parts of the services tonight. Please help it all to go well. Please give us rain and moisture. Please help our country. Please help whoever needs to be saved to be saved tonight. And if you want someone to be a missionary for you, please call them, or pastor. Please call them to be a missionary or pastor. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Y'all can keep your seats and turn over to page 20, 30. Turn over to page 27.
On a hill far away, stood alone.
Hello, my peoples. So today is the Youth Night, and not to lie, I'm kind of nervous about it. As y'all could tell, I got sidetracked a little in the song. So. Oh, and don't forget the chili cook-off back there. Please stay, because it's free food. It's free food. Unless, right. Don't forget about the Roberts anniversary. It's today. So. Oh, it's Wednesday. Okay, I was wrong. It was this week. You could have forgot about it. You never know. The men's prayer breakfast, February 6th at 8:30 a.m. So whoever don't like to get up, better get up. It's food. And then the 7th at 6:30 p.m. Sunday evening, we have the missionary Stephen Trimble to the Philippines. And then Sunday evening, February 14th, we have at 6 p.m. we have the John 3:16 banquet. Don't get that confused with Valentine's Day now, because it's our love to God and His love to us, not other people. And then on the 28th, we have the crazy sweater contest Sunday evening at 6:30 p.m. Please stand for offering page 401.
being nervous, I think he's doing an okay job. Andrew, would you ask God's blessing on the offering, please?
Ethan and Eli as they preach, and for the chili cook-off to go well after the service, in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. You may be seated.
Tend to make excuses, we tend to pass the blame. We fail to see our failures as more than just mistakes. We can see the wrong in others, overlooking the evil within. So Lord, help us to confront our, to confess and forsake our sins. For the heart
is so deceitful, so desperately wicked within. And just the time I think I'm fine, I've deceived myself again. So create in me a clean heart, one that's faithful, pure, and true. And search my heart and try me. Help me, Lord, to follow you. For the heart to hide every sinful part. message tonight is on enemies and friends. Will you please pray for me? Pray with me. Dear Jesus, we thank you for the day you've given us so far, Lord. We thank you for the opportunity for the youth being able to run the service tonight, Lord. We ask you to be at the service, Lord, and the chili cook-off afterward, Lord, and hope to be for your glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Will you please turn your Bibles to Matthew? Matthew chapter 5. Verse 44. It says, "But I say unto you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you." My first point tonight is we need to love our enemies. We should not hate our enemies. If they are mean to us, we shouldn't retaliate and be mean to them back. We need to have a loving spirit. We should love them and be really nice to them. My second point tonight is pray for our enemies. Please turn your Bibles to Acts chapter 7. Verse 60. He kneeled down and cried with a loud voice, "Lord, lay not this sin to their charge." And when he had said this, he fell asleep. While Stephen was being stoned, he prayed for his enemies. It will help us to love them more if we pray for them. Every time we pray, we should pray for our enemies. And my third point tonight is forgive our enemies. If you please turn your Bibles to Luke chapter 23. Chapter 23, verse 34. It says, "And then said Jesus, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And they parted his raiment and cast lots." Christ forgave his enemies while he was on the cross. Every time we pray, we should forgive our enemies. And if you'll turn your Bibles to Matthew 18. Verse 22. It says, "Jesus saith unto them, I say not unto thee until seven times, but until 70 times seven." We need to forgive our enemies 70 times seven. Not just that, but beyond that. And always forgive our enemies. My fourth point tonight is Christ will deliver us from our enemies. In Deuteronomy chapter 32. Chapter 32, verse 35. "To me belongeth vengeance and recompense. Their foot shall slide in due time, for the day their calamity is at hand, and the things that shall come upon them make haste." Christ said vengeance is his.
Amen.
We should not be angry with our enemies because vengeance is the Lord's. We need to leave it to the Lord for them to have vengeance. And our friends, in Proverbs chapter 16, verse 28 says, "Froward man soweth strife, and a whisperer separate his chief friends." We should not gossip about our friends. The more we gossip, the more we lose friends, and the more that they will be angry at us, and they will dislike us. In Proverbs 17:17, it says, "Friend loveth at all times, and a brother is born for adversity." We should love our friends like Jesus loved us. And John 15, through 15, it says, "Greater love hath no man than this, than a man lay down his life for his friends. Ye are my friends, if ye do whatsoever I command you. Henceforth I call you not servants, for the servant knoweth not what his Lord doeth. But I have called you friends, for all things that I have heard of my Father I have made known unto you." We should be willing to sacrifice anything for our friends. that is a real friendship and a great friendship. Jesus is our greatest friend. He called us his friends and not his servants. And if you'll please turn your Bibles over to Proverbs 18. Proverbs 18, verse 24. It says, a man that hath friends must show himself friendly, and there is a friend that sticketh closer than a brother. Jesus is that friend that sticketh closer than a brother. We should love and treat our friends like the way we want to be treated and how Jesus treated men while he was on the earth. And if you'll turn your Bibles over to 1 Samuel 18. Verse 1 through 4 says, and it came to pass, when he had made an end of speaking unto Saul, that the soul of Jonathan was knit with the soul of David, and Jonathan loved him as his own soul. And Saul took him that day and would let him go no more home to his father's house. Then Jonathan and David made a covenant because he loved him as his own soul. Jonathan stripped himself of the robe that was upon him and gave it to David and his garments, even to his sword and to his bow and to his girdle. Jonathan was a great friend to David. We should be a Jonathan toward our friends. 1 Samuel 21 through 29 also shows Jonathan's friendship. My challenge today is to love our enemies, pray for our enemies, forgive our enemies, and Christ will deliver us from our enemies, and to treat friends like we want to be treated. Will you please bow in prayer with me? Dear Jesus, we thank you for the teens being able to take over the service, Lord. We thank you for the messages being preached, Lord, that you would just be with them, Lord, and that you just give us a good rest tonight, Lord, and be with Eli as he preaches. In Jesus' name, amen.
The title of my message tonight is The ABCs of Salvation. This is not a new subject. We all have heard these Bible verses. Number one, A. First, we have to admit that we are sinners. In Romans 3:10, it says, as it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. And in 3:23, it says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. In 5:12, it says, wherefore, as by one man, sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. These verses all talk about how we are sinners, and we are in dying need of salvation. There was no one that was sinless. There was only one that was sinless. That was Jesus Christ. Number two, B, we have to believe that Christ came to take away the sins of the world. In Romans chapter 5 and verses 6 and through 9, it says, for when we were yet without strength, in due time, Christ died for the ungodly. For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God committed his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Much more than being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. Jesus paid the ultimate price for our sins so we can be saved and live eternity with him. Last point, we need to confess our sins and call upon the name of the Lord. In Romans 10, verses 9 through 13, it says, if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture saith, whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. For there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek, for the same Lord is over all, is rich unto all that call upon him. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Amen. Calling on the Lord, on Jesus, might be the most crucial thing that you might ever do in your life. Amen. With these 3 points, we take away that first we have to admit that we are sinners, we have to believe that Jesus died for our sins, and we have to call upon the name of the Lord. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, thank for day, Lord. Thank for allowing us beer day. Lord, thank for allowing the teens to take over the service, Lord. Just use these messages to touch the hearts of the congregation. Lord, help the rest of the evening to go well. And I ask these things in your name.
I did not give the teens a time limit. I told them if they preached long enough, I would not preach. We got almost there. If you open your Bibles to Hebrews chapter 10. Growing up, I remember being a teen and the first time getting behind the pulpit to lead songs and to preach and all that, how nervous. You didn't want to look at anybody. Because you were afraid that if you looked at somebody in the eye, you would kill over dead or something. But Hebrews chapter 10. I'm going to start in verse number 23. It says, "Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful that promised. And let us consider one another to provoke unto love and to good works." Let's open in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you for this day, and Lord, I thank you for the messages that we've already heard. And Lord, each one of them was good in their in the points that they covered. And Lord, it was your word, and so it's always good. And Lord, I do thank you for it. Lord, I thank you for the opportunity to work with the teens a little bit and to teach them. And Lord, even the opportunity for me here now to share your word a little bit. Lord, I do pray that you would just be honored and glorified. And Lord, I pray that you would help us to take the messages that we've heard. And Lord, I pray that you would help us to apply it to our lives. Lord, I pray you'd help us to be the friend you'd want us to be. And Lord, if somebody's here that doesn't know you as a personal Savior, Lord, I pray that today they would get that right. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. When I was looking at what to preach, just in case, the verse that we picked for the bulletin board out front in the foyer was Hebrews 10:24. It says, "Let us consider one another to provoke unto love and good works." I like the word provoke. We all like the word provoke. A lot of times we just don't do it scripturally. provoke, we like to provoke to get a reaction of some sort. The Bible tells fathers not to provoke their children to wrath. It's fun. God says not to do it. Like most sin, it is fun, but there's a consequence that happens on the end. Here, the writer of Hebrews lays out what we should be doing as believers. You know, when we come into a church setting, we sometimes think it's the pastor's job to teach, or it's the youth pastor's job to teach the teens. If the teens are getting out of line, Brother Looney, you need to fix it. Well, there's only so much I can do. I can only reinforce what they're learning at home. But my job is to provoke them to love and good works. But first of all, before I can be effective in that, I have to hold fast. I have to hold fast the profession of our faith. I have to hold fast to beliefs, what the Bible says. Because if I'm going to provoke somebody into the service of God, to be a better servant of God, I first have to believe it. If you don't believe it, it's going to be really hard to convince somebody else to do it. And we have to be able, and we have to do it without any wavering. That James 1:8, it refers to a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. Sometimes we have a tendency to say, yes, I believe, but we really don't. It's easy to say something. It's another thing to act upon what you just said. You know that old saying, it's easier said than done? But we have to hold fast to that. We have to hold fast to our convictions and to our standards. I've seen it growing up in church. I've seen it over and over and over again. People who once had really high standards and really strong standards now no longer have those same standards. And you look at the kids, and you wonder why, you don't really wonder, you know why they're no longer where they should be. It's because mom and dad have slipped, or the pastor has slipped, or the youth director has slipped in his convictions and his standards, and everything follows. You know, we've heard the same statement, the apple doesn't fall far from the tree. One thing I've noticed is the apple never falls in the same exact spot that the tree's in. Right? You have a tree here, the apple's going to fall over here. And if that apple were to grow a tree, it's no longer in the same spot, and it's going to just keep going further, right? I mean, it makes sense. But our children and those that we are to teach or to provoke, if you will, aren't going to hold the same standards that we hold. So if our standards are low, their standards are going to be, and their convictions are going to be even lower. So where are we? Are we holding fast? If we don't have that first point, then the next point is kind of, we can't really, or the next points are kind of pointless. I mean, really, if you don't have the beliefs, then what's the point? Then why are we here? Why are we wasting our time? The next thing that says here, it says to, in verse number 24, it says, let us consider. The word consider, if you don't know, means to think about. To think about. How often do we think about somebody else in the church? It's kind of hard to provoke somebody when you're not thinking about them. I mean, I know none of you have fallen into this trap, but I'll admit I have. There's been times somebody's like, well, where's so-and-so? I'm like, you know, now you say that, I don't think I've actually seen them. You know, because, and the reason why is because I wasn't thinking about them. Because I wasn't doing what God said to do and to consider one another, to think about them, to try to encourage them. You can't encourage somebody if you're not thinking about them, you know. In Philippians chapter 2 and verses 1 through 4, it says, if there be therefore any consolation in Christ, any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any bowels of mercy, fulfill ye my joy, that ye be like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord of one mind. Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in the lowliness of mind, let each esteem other better than themselves. Look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. See, we get self-focused. It's about me and my problems and what I'm going through. When that person in the pew in front of you, behind you, next to you, whichever, they've got problems too. You know, that person behind you may have physical ailments that they may not be the same physical ailments, but they may have a physical ailment of some sort. You know, I'm recovering from a broken ankle. I have a physical ailment. I am not the only one in this church that's recovering from a physical ailment. But I should be focused on you. And you should be focused on me. People who deal with depression, a lot of times if you were asked them, now there's medical things and stuff, but a lot of times the ones who are dealing with depression, if you ask them what they focus on, it's all about themselves. And my problems, and how bad my life is. Well, yeah, if you focus on yourself, of course you're going to be depressed. Think about others. The Bible tells us to think about others for a reason. Are we esteeming others better than ourselves? Are we looking every man on his, look not every man on his own things, but every man on the things of others? So are we looking at our stuff and worried about what we're going through? Or are we genuinely concerned about what others are going through? When you have the convictions and the beliefs and the convictions and you're thinking about others, it's real easy to then provoke them. The word provoke means to call to action. See, when I was growing up, I had three older sisters. It was easy to provoke them to get a response. If you haven't noticed, girls are a lot more emotional, and you play on their emotions, pull their strings just a little bit, and you can get all sorts of reactions. And as the younger brother, it was fun. Not right, but it was fun. But I could provoke them. I could get an action out of them. But the provoking that we have here is, God says we should provoke others to love and to good works. To love and to good works. We all know if you're married here, you know that it's easy to provoke love if you're willing to work at it, to get that good response. You know, like remembering that your anniversary is today, not this week. Just kidding. Forgetting your anniversary does not help the situation. Well, when you've only been married, you know, for a couple of years, it's pretty easy to remember. When you put it in your phone and you get a reminder. I love technology. But provoke, calling to action. See, Jesus provoked. In John 4:35, it says, "Say not ye that there are yet 4 months and then cometh harvest. Behold, I say unto you, lift up your eyes and look on the fields, for they are white already to harvest." He was provoking his disciples to action. It's not time to be sitting around doing nothing. It's time to get to work. I had the privilege, if you want to call it that, to work at a grain elevator when we were living up in Stratford with my parents. And my eyes were really open to the whole harvest thing. When harvest at the grain elevator, I did not make a whole lot hourly. But harvest time, that's when you made your good money. It was 13-hour days, 7 days a week. And that's a lot of hours. And it's good paychecks. And the reason why is because the harvest has to get in. If it stays out in the field, that's money lost. Jesus is saying the same thing when it comes to souls. It's the harvest is ready. We got to get to work. Not time to be sitting around. Paul also provoked. In 1 Corinthians 16:13, he said, "Watch ye, stand fast in the faith. Quit you like men, be strong." This is one of my favorite verses, especially when I'm dealing with people when they want to quit early. When do men quit? When the job's done. When the job's done. Paul was telling the church there at Corinth, he goes, "The job's not done. Keep going. Keep going. Don't quit. Be strong." The challenge, we got three challenges this evening. One on loving your enemies. Ethan did a good job of provoking us to love our enemies and to pray for them. We have a tendency to pray at them, but we need to pray for them. Provoke. Be the friend that we should be. Of course, it's a lot easier when you're thinking about others and not yourself. If you're not saved, get saved. We've been provoked. My challenge to you as a church, who are you provoking to love and good works? Because see, it's not just my job or the pastor's job or the Sunday school teacher's job. It's everybody's job. Amen. Find somebody who's not doing what, maybe they're not quite as strong of a Christian, and maybe you see some weak areas, and come alongside them and see if you can maybe be a help to them. That means we have to get out of our comfort zone. At the youth rally, I told our teens, are like, what do you want us to do? It was right at the beginning when everybody's coming in. I'm like, all I want for you to do is go and meet somebody new. And they all looked at me like, what? We have to go talk to somebody. So like some of the teen boys were following Logan around because Logan doesn't know a stranger. So he's going around telling everybody. but go and provoke others to love and good works. Go out and be the friend that God would want you to be, the friend that you know that God would want you to be. Be the church member that God would want you to be. Be the soul winner that God would want you to be. Be the tither that God would want you to be. You can't provoke someone to do something that you're not doing yourself. So what about you? Examine your life. Where are you at? Have your convictions slipped? Is there beliefs that you're trying to fake it till you make it type thing? If there are, there's people here that can help you. I mean, we have a pretty good pastor. So he can help you. There's other men who've been in the ministry a day or two that can help you. There's other people, they may not even been in the ministry, but there are other people here that can help you get those beliefs settled and get them nailed down. And then try to be an encouragement to others. Try to be that, do that thing that we all like to do, whether you like to admit it or not. We all like to provoke. But make sure we're provoking people in the right direction. Pastor.
I don't know about you, but I enjoyed that. Amen.